There's also cultural examples that are associated with sort of larger events that have occurred. And one particular example that is somewhat recent is a major security culture lapse that occurred in July of 2012.
Okay, so two peace activists and a nun walk into a nuclear energy complex. Sounds like the beginning of a bad joke, right? But that is exactly what happened last year, and now the trio is facing a slew of charges for everything from sabotage to the destruction of federal property. 64-year-old Michael Wally, 57-year-old Greg Borgi Obed, and 83-year-old nun Megan Rice broke into a secure facility where enriched uranium for nuclear bombs is stored. The group cut a fence at the Y-12 National Security Complex in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, back in July, and then walked around for hours spray-painting slogans and taking hammers to the facility walls. As a result, federal officials say they were forced to shut down that facility for 15 days, a delay prosecutors claim damages America's credibility in terms of nuclear deterrence. Now, just a short time after this break-in occurred, an Energy Department Inspector General report actually found, quote, troubling displays of ineptitude at that complex.
This was at the Y-12 National Security Complex in Oak Ridge, Tennessee. Three particular anti-nuclear activists entered this facility, and the three individuals that entered it are not maybe what you might think of as nuclear security threats. One of the individuals, an 83-year-old nun, and then the two other individuals was a 63-year-old and a 57-year-old male. So these were relatively senior individuals. And they entered this facility that has a very, very detailed and rigorous nuclear security system. From a physical security standpoint, it is a very hardened system. They had actually just upgraded that facility with $200 million worth of additional upgrades for the security system on that facility. And all of that equipment was in place, but the equipment had been giving false alarms. There had been parts of the equipment that were alarming, and the guards had learned after a while to just ignore those alarms. Just don't pay attention to them, don't bother with it. These three activists made use of that. It's not clear whether that they knew about the fact that those false alarms were occurring, but they made use of that as a means to acquire access to the facility, and they actually moved all the way in towards a vault location where they actually painted slogans, anti-nuclear slogans, on the vault. So while they didn't actually get inside the vault, they got all the way to the door of the vault before anyone stopped them. That's a fairly serious lapse in judgment by the human personnel at the facility. And of course, we were lucky in a way that this occurred because these particular individuals were not terrorists. They were not a criminal group from the standpoint they were trying to cause harm. They simply wanted to make their opinions about anti-nuclear activities known. And so they didn't take any action that actually caused any harm to other humans. But it did, however, cause a lot of harm to the facility in terms of its continued operation.
Well, Robin and John, the purpose of this morning's hearing was to take a close look at what's needed to maintain the highest levels of performance, safety, and security at the nation's seven nuclear weapons sites. But it's clear tonight that lawmakers are using the security breach at Y-12 as an example of a best-case scenario that resulted from catastrophic failings among the highest levels of management.
That was the perception, is it had to be Fort Knox type of security?
This is my nearly 40 years in the Department of Energy. Y-12 was the Fort Knox of the department.
That statement is now up for debate after three protesters broke into the Oak Ridge nuclear facility on July 28th. They all face federal charges and could serve prison time. On Monday, federal lawmakers heard from the federal employees who are ultimately in charge of the facility about the serious breach.
It is difficult to strike precisely the right balance between the contractor's desire to operate without undue oversight and the government's need to ensure the taxpayers' interests.
An inspector general's report revealed last month that the trespassers cut through four fences. At the hearing of the Energy and Commerce Oversight Committee, IG Gregory Friedman said that they are chain link. Some security cameras had been off for 6 months or more. Thomas D'Agostino, administrator of the National Nuclear Security Administration, the federal office that oversees Y-12 contractor B&W and security contractor WSI, admitted the fix for those was as simple as flipping a switch. Those cameras were fixed immediately following the break-in.
It's inexcusable. It's appalling. The language the committee has used here, I would agree with.
Tennessee Republican Congresswoman Marsha Blackburn didn't hold back her anger.
In that area, you are charged with keeping that facility safe. You are charged with keeping the employees at that facility safe. And it is such the ineptness and the negligence is mind-boggling.
The organization that was running that facility lost their contract to run and operate this facility, which is worth millions to billions of dollars. And a lot of that is just because the guards that were there, the security personnel, were just bored. They didn't believe that there was a real threat, that the threat didn't exist. And because of that, they didn't take actions whenever things occurred. They also entered into a lapse where they just got used to certain alarms occurring. Now, of course, they're under much greater scrutiny at that facility. And in fact, the entire Department of Energy, U.S. Department of Energy complex is in a shakeup over this. The U.S. Department of Energy might potentially take over all security forces at all of the U.S. Department of Energy facilities in order to try to eliminate this. Now, the problem with that is why did this occur? Who was responsible for this? Obviously, the answer is the guards had a responsibility, but most of us would say that that responsibility actually goes long, well beyond just those particular guards. It is really due to a cultural problem that existed both within the facility as well as within the entire infrastructure as a whole. And it starts with this basic concept up here of, did they believe that there was a real threat? And does everyone within the structure believe that? So what we do is we have to take a look at this and say that nuclear security culture is an important part of every security infrastructure. No matter how good your hardware is, without the people behind it, that hardware will not serve any purpose in securing those facilities. Those humans are very important.